Ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to present one of America's most exciting musical personalities, a man that, well, I don't know, you want to say he's been hot a couple of times. You remember him from with the first edition, Christy Minstrels. He's back now all by himself and knocking him dead. I mean, who is selling more records today? Here is the Grammy winner, 1978's Country Music Male Vocalist of the Year, Kenny Rogers, right here. Good-looking guy, isn't he? Huh? You wanted to talk to him?
I just wanted to know how they got their group name.
The group name?
Yeah.
The group name, the group is called Bloodline. And they got that because there were other group names that we chose that were already taken. They were originally called Turning Point, and there was another group called Turning Point that immediately proceeded to sue them, decided that was not the right approach, so we dropped that right quick.
You know, I read where you said that... kind of interesting. You're a candid guy, I tell you. They'll never accuse you of not telling what you think. You figure to be hot for another 2 years?
The music business is so predictable.
Really?
If you really go back, and you take any example that you want to take, that usually it's very cyclical. You'll run about 3 years of being really hot, and then 25 years of being cold, and 3 years of being hot. No, but it's pretty predictable. If you go back and look at who was big. Elton John was so big for like 3 or 4 years, and it's not that he's not capable of being big. I think intentionally he kind of dropped out of sight. He just got tired of the pace, and he backs off for a while. And the people get, I think, saturated after a while.
And so you now know that you're riding a sort of a wave. Is that how you want to say it?
Yeah, I look at it as hills and valleys, you know, and I think that I'm, at this point, at least toward the top of the hill.
Sure.
And I think I've got 2 more years where I am, and then you'll have trouble finding me again.
So. But then I presume that your game plan is to be resurrected somehow after a certain...
Possibly. Yeah, I don't know. I haven't decided yet whether I have the energy. There's a certain adrenaline of youth that goes with this job that I think is important to success, that when you're young, you'll sacrifice and sacrifice and sacrifice. I don't know that I've got that again. I think that the trick is at this time to invest properly so that I don't at least have to worry about whether I have another resurgence.
But with all the focus on you now with the Grammy and you're the top man in your game, can you adjust? Can you go fishing and enjoy it? I mean, after all the attention and the lights?
Yeah, in fact, that's one of the few places I can go is fishing. It's amazing how few people there are out there when you get out.
Yeah.
But I enjoy that. And my mother is a big fisherwoman. She takes me fishing all the time when I get a chance to go. I love that.
Right.
But there are some places that 8 months ago, I made a comment to somebody that I said that I was in the perfect position. I signed enough autographs to satisfy my ego, but not enough to invade my privacy. And all of a sudden, it's kind of flip-flop now that it really is getting to be. To one of my pet peeves is when someone comes to my door in the hotel room at 2 o'clock in the morning and says, yes, but we drove 100 miles, you know, I've been asleep for 2 hours, you know.
I know. Tell me about Lucille, because every time you record a song, it replaces your last recording. It's my favorite. Lucille is just a heck of a story idea. I thought the guy was going to floor you right there at the bar.
So did I. Even when I was singing the song, I kept saying, somehow this is not real. I can't imagine me sitting there, sitting with some guy's wife, and him saying, yeah, but it's been a tough life, honey. Why don't you come back home? You know, that's just not the way it works in those bars. I've been in too many of them.
Right. So what's the story? Who?
I didn't write the song. It was written by two guys from Nashville. And they're really excellent songwriters. And they captured a real slice of Americana there, because there was some big university did an entire semester of psychological profiles. They made Lucille, where they had to write a thesis on this song of the different personalities. And if you get into it, there's really like four distinctive personalities. And they're all totally different.
Right.
And as to why they reacted certain ways on the
right.
song.
And in the country music tradition, folklore, he's running around. He's the guy that takes off.
As a rule, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And now we've got the reverse of rule here. Well, do the song and then let's see how that.
Okay.
This is.
Listen to the different personalities in this song, because that's what. In a bar in Toledo, across from the depot, on a bar stool, she took off her ring. I thought I'd get closer, so I walked on over. I sat down and asked her her name. When the drinks finally hit her, she said, I'm no quitter, but I finally quit living on dreams. I'm hungry for laughter here ever after. I'm after whatever the other life brings. In the mirror I saw him, and I closely watched him. I thought how he looked out of place. He came to the woman who sat there beside me. He had a strange look on his face. Now his big hands were calloused. He looked like a mountain. For a minute, I thought I was dead. But he started shaking, his big heart was breaking, and he turned to the woman and said, you picked to find time to leave me, Lucille, with four hungry children and a crop in the field. Lived through some sad times, but this time you hurt me on me. You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille. After he left us, I ordered more whiskey. I thought how she made him look small. From the lights of the bar room to a rented hotel room, we walked without talking at all. Now she was a beauty, but when she came to me, she must have thought I'd lost my mind. 'Cause I couldn't hold her, the words that he told her kept coming back time after time. You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille, with four hungry children and the crops in the field. Now I've had some bad times, lived through some sad times, but this time you hurt and won't heal. You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille. You picked a fine time to leave me Lucy.
Children?
Do I have any children? Yes, I have two children from previous marriages.
How old are they?
I have a son, 14, and a daughter who's almost 20.
Thank you.
Does anybody get through your game without previous marriages?
I don't know how, truthfully, because first of all, this business is really not conducive to good marriage at certain stages in the career. I think that even in my own case, I think it's possible that when I first started that I actually sacrificed marriages for success. I think success was so important to me. Because I came from a very poor family, and my mother had worked very hard to get me into college, and my father. And when I quit
college.
This was
Houston?
In Houston. When I quit college to become a musician, oh Lord, you know what that did to him. I was the first child in my entire lineage to ever graduate from high school, and they had really put a lot of hopes on me. So I think success became so important to me that I'm not sure, unintentionally, I mean subliminally, that I wasn't willing to sacrifice relationships for success at one point. I wouldn't do it again, I must say.
I'd like to know how much of your own music you write.
I probably write about maybe 30 or 40%. I don't really consider myself a songwriter. I think I'm capable of writing, but I'm not the kind of person that can sit down on a Tuesday and say, okay, I'm going to write a song today. I just can't do that. I have to kind of write from inspiration or from something that happens and as a situation develops.
That's what I was going to ask you. What kind of things inspire you to write?
Usually, I write from either personal experiences. I wrote a song called Sweet Music Man that, and looking back at the song, when I wrote it, actually I wrote it third person, and I was kind of assuming what this person must have gone through. But once I finished writing the song and having now listened back to it, I realized there's an awful lot of my own insecurities that came out in that song that I would have never had the guts to write had I said I'm going to write a song about my insecurities.
Now, which song was that?
Sweet Music Man.
Tell me about those insecurities.
Well, there's a lyric in there that says, but you try to stay young, but the songs you've sung to so many people have all begun to come back on you. And this was at a time when I was, the first edition had broken up, and I was really searching for an identity of my own. I mean, I was trying to wear leather suits and this, that, and the other in order to appear more congruent with what was happening musically. And I realized that it really wasn't me, that it was sad to me that I had to kind of reach outside of me for identity. And so what I really started striving for, and the best thing I have going for me right now, is that I am successful being me. And I don't have any of these facades, and I don't have to wear makeup, and I don't have to do this, that, and the other. And consequently, if it ends tomorrow, I can honestly say I've enjoyed my life, and I've enjoyed what I'm doing, because I don't have to worry about
it. You were really trying to present younger then, isn't that what you're saying?
Yeah, well, when the first edition put itself together, I say that literally, we were all members of the New Christy Minstrels, and they didn't want me with the group because I was about 6 years older than the guy. So that's when I grew my beard, was my first attempt at some identity change in order to relate more to the younger people. And I even went through a stage of 2 years where I wore an earring in my ear, but at the time I was comfortable with it. I have to say that also. It was, you know, you grow out of things as you get older also.
Did the gray hair psych you?
No, I kind of, it's like anything else. When my beard came in, it first came in with salt and pepper gray, and it's like any experiment. I think you react according to reactions, and had people said, oh, you know, what a terrible looking beard, or what this, that, and that. But all the response I got was very positive. Mm-hmm. And I must say that I shaved it off in December, and I remember standing in front of the mirror with my wife saying, God, I remember being a lot cuter than that. I don't, you know, so I grew it back very quickly. I want you to know that, too. So,
Kenny, you said that you probably have about 2 more years while you're on the top. What do you hope to do after you're not singing anymore? Do you have any plans for your...
Well, I don't know that I won't continue singing. The truth is, once you get to a certain plateau in this business, you never go down quite as far. You still go, I mean, you can't stay up here. But, you know, I might get down here, but I should never be down here again. I should never be at the very bottom again because I think I'm too good a businessman to allow that to happen. As far as what I would enjoy doing, if I could have anything in the world, I'd be a tennis professional. Unfortunately, I don't play well enough to be a tennis professional. So, I don't know. There are a lot of things that I enjoy doing. I'm very business-oriented. I have a lot of investments that I thoroughly enjoy. It's good therapy for me also.
We're in Chicago with Kenny Rogers, whose latest album is titled The Gambler, not surprisingly, since that's such a smash for him. And we'll be back with Kenny in just a moment. That's Kenny Rogers and Bloodline.
Yes.
Yes, I was just wondering, who's been the biggest influence in your career, or is there anyone?
Musically, when I was a kid, I think the two people that were the strongest musical influences on me were Ray Charles and Sam Cooke. And while I don't feel I necessarily sing like either of the two as much as I would love to think that I could, I think they were more inspirations than influences. I mean, when I was a kid, I used to see those guys performing on stage, and I would think, what a great idea to be able to sing and make music and do something you enjoy and be paid for it. So it was kind of an inspiration for me to stay in there and keep plugging when things weren't that great. I kept thinking, you know, well, they did it, and if I stay in here sooner or later, you know, maybe things will work for me. So I think that's very important also.
Within the last few months, you played Waukesha, Wisconsin. Are you too big to play such small towns now, or?
No, not really. The thing is with me, if you give me my choice, I would rather play small towns, and I'll tell you why. Because small town people are not as blasé as the metropolitan towns are. They really enjoy it when you come to town because they don't have everybody coming through 14 concerts a week, and it's nice to go in, and there's a freshness that happens there that you can't find, you know, in major cities. And last night, I must say, in all fairness, we had just tremendous audiences. The country people have a way of bringing that level of excitement up, no matter what city you're in. But the smaller towns, I personally enjoy playing.
Kenny, with your new album being The Gambler, is there any truth to the rumor that there's going to be a TV series off of this song?
There's a TV special. It's a movie of the week that we're hopefully doing. We've been given approval to do it. It's a question now of whether we can put all of the ingredients together to make it really as good as I would like to see it. And while I don't have total control over it, I have enough control to where I can, if it's not what I thought, what I had hoped it would be, and it's a vehicle for me, and if it's not going to work right, then I don't want to do it. But yes, we hope to start shooting in July on that.
She Believes in Me. Uh-huh. Now, who wrote this? You didn't write?
No, I didn't write this. I make it a point never to write hits. I only write. It's a personal thing with me. But this was written by a kid named Stephen Gibb out of, he lives in Nashville now. Where he lived originally, I don't know. But I did this on The Tonight Show, I guess about 9 or 10 weeks ago. And at the time, I said that I felt this was the best song I had ever recorded. And I stick by my guns. I really believe it.
Okay, let's hear that. Kenny Rogers.
She lay sleeping. I stay out late at night and play my songs. And sometimes all the nights can be so long. And it's good when I finally make it home. Oh. Try to get undressed without a lie. Then quietly she says, how was your night? And I come here and say, it was all right. And I hold her tight. And she she was my girl, I could change the world with my little songs. I was wrong, but she has faith in me, and so I'll go trying faithfully. And who knows, maybe on some special night, my song is right, I can find a way, while she lays waiting. I stumble to the kitchen for a bite, and I see my old guitar in the night. Just waiting for me like
a secret friend, and there's no wind while she lays crying. I fumble with a melody or two, and I'm torn between the things that I should do. And she says to wake her up when I'm through. God, I love this tree. And she believes in me. I'll never know just what she sees in me. I told her someday if she was my girl, change the world with my little songs. I was wrong, but she has faith in me, and so I'll go trying faithfully. And who knows, maybe on some special night, my song is right, I can find a way. While she lives, while she waits for.
That's Kenny Rogers. Yes.
Yes. I want to know whatever possessed you to shave off that beautiful beard.
The truth of the matter is I had had this beard for almost 12 years, 13 years, and I had really forgotten what I looked like. And my wife had never seen what I looked like, and she felt that she deserved that, and so did I. And she wanted to know if we had children, if they would have a chin or if they came out with a beard or what. So I went in, I guess, a year ago, Christmas a year ago, and started to shave it. I had a month off. And I found that it was really such a tremendous identification with me. And it's funny because people in this business look for anonymity until it's given to them, and then they don't want it. So it also all of a sudden frightened me that I would walk outside and no one would know who I was, you know. And so I couldn't shave it. And for a year, it really bothered me that I wasn't strong enough to shave my beard off. I mean, even though I could have grown it back immediately, it really bothered me that I didn't have the strength of character to just shave it and live with whatever happened. So a year later, I shaved it, and then realized why I shouldn't have ever bothered anyhow. It was interesting, really. I must say, it's kind of like the military service. I'm glad I did it, but I wouldn't want to do it again.
Yes.
First, I'd like to say how much I admire you. And I'd
Thank
like
you.
To know if we love going to the Grand Ole Opry. Do you ever appear down there anymore?
I have not appeared on the Opry really for no particular purpose other than my schedule in Nashville is usually very hectic because my wife is one of the girls on Hee Haw. So I try to go in with her when she films in June and October. And I also try to record at the same time that I'm there. And I've been invited to appear on the Opry, and the time just hasn't presented itself. But I ultimately will, because I think that's a great establishment and it does an awful lot for country music.
Your wife is the beautiful, sexy She's a model as well as working hee-haw. Huh?
All of that.
Marianne
Gordon was her. It's actually Marianne Gordon Rogers now. We decided to go ahead and use the full name. But she is, you know, the best thing that's ever happened to me, and I say that unequivocally. She's just an incredible person, and it was funny because she was the one that really gave me the strength to continue when the first edition broke up. I mean, I don't think I ever really had any doubt that I could do it again because I've never felt I was a good singer, but I've always felt I was commercial. I felt with the right piece of material I could work again or do well again. And she's the one that finally taught me and made me finally realize that success was not the most important thing in the world. We were tremendously happy when we had nothing. So once we got something, the trick was to keep the happiness while the success came, as opposed to losing the happiness then.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to ask you how you did meet your wife and if that last song was dedicated to her at all.
First of all, the first part of the question, I met my wife while she was doing Hee Haw, and I was there seeing some other friends of mine, and they introduced me to her. And went back to L.A., and it was several months before I saw her again, and we actually ran into each other at a Christmas party. We had mutual friends that we didn't know we had. And she got me started playing tennis. I had never played tennis until then, and she regrets that, I assure you, because she's a tennis widow at this point. But we developed a friendship first, and we actually saw each other for four years, before we finally got married. We've been married a year and a half now. And in answer to the last part of your question, I didn't write the song, so it's hard for me to dedicate another person's writings. I must say that every time I sing it, though, without exception, I always think about the fact that she was the real strength behind me in that situation. So I think that's the reason I feel I interpret it as well as I do.
Yeah.
When you did leave college to become a musician, how did you get your first big break in the business?
Well, ironically, I thought I went to college 2 semesters. My mother says I went 2 weeks. So somewhere between 2 weeks and 2 semesters is the amount of college I have. And I left college because I had a job, actually. I had 2 jobs. I was holding down 2 jobs. I was selling office supplies during the day and doing very well at it. And I had a night job as a musician. And ultimately, something had to go. And I was developing feelings that I really wanted to be a professional musician. And I was starting to get the type of... The group was formed in Houston called the Bobby Doyle Three, and we were a jazz group, really. And we worked for about 9 years, and it was I felt a perfection in this kid, Bobby Doyle, who, yet aside from Ray Charles, and coincidentally, they're both blind, but I felt such a magic with this kid that I knew I could learn so much from him that college really didn't have to offer me at the time, because I was studying commercial art and some psychology courses, but in 2 weeks, how much can you learn? I don't know.
Will you introduce the members of your group?
Will I introduce them? Oh, no, I couldn't do that. Of course I'll introduce them. On rhythm guitar, here's Randy Dorman. Back in the back is Steve Glassmeyer. On rhythm guitar and a multitude of different instruments when we have them, Edgar Struble. And at drums is Bobby Daniel. Chuck Jacobs, playing bass. Gene Golden on organ. And from the Windy City, Rick Harper.
The Gambler is very much on the charts now. And did you know that this was going to be Smasheroo?
I knew it was going to be a commercial success. How... It went in the pop charts was the real question. I really felt it was going to be a top country record because it's such an identification factor there. I was surprised, but yet kind of predicting that it would do well, but not how well. It went to, like, I guess, number 12 in the pop charts, which is really excellent nowadays. That means there are only 11 records in the country that sold better than it did during that period.
The Gambler.
The Gambler.
Here's Kenny Rogers.
On a warm summer's evening, on a train bound for nowhere, I met up with a gambler. We were both too tired to sleep, so we took turns staring out the window at the darkness till boredom overtook us. And he began to speak. He said, "Son, I've made my life out of reading people's faces, knowing what the cards were by the way they held their eyes."
And if you don't mind me saying, I can see you're out of aces. For a taste of your whiskey, I'll give you some advice. So I handed him my bottle, and he drank down my last swallow. Then he bummed a cigarette and asked me for a light. And the night got deathly quiet, and his face lost all expression. Said, if you're gonna play the game, boy, you gotta learn to play it right. You got to know when to hold on, know when to fold on, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. Now every gambler knows that the secret to surviving is knowing what to throw away and knowing what to keep. Cause every hand's a winner and every hand's a loser, and the best you can hope for is to die in your sleep. So when he'd finished speaking, he turned back toward the window, crushed out his cigarette and faded off to sleep. Then somewhere in the darkness, the gambler, he broke even. But in his final words, I found an ace that I could keep. You got to know when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. You got to know when to hold on, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. You got to know when to hold on, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the deal is done.
In Chicago with Kenny Rogers, who incidentally is has a CBS special coming up. For those of you watching us in some cities, we don't want to confuse you. It's a week from Thursday for some of you. For some of you, it's this Thursday. So check your local listings. A special Kenny Rogers on CBS. Hi.
Hi. I would like to ask a personal question.
Okay.
How old are you?
I'm 40 years old. I was born. You guessed it?
Yeah.
Oh, well, here's a dollar. I am.
Yes.
You mentioned you have children. Are either one of them musically inclined?
I think they both probably are. My daughter, who is now, as I said, almost 20, has just expressed an interest to me in the last 6 months or so that she would like to get into this business. So I have a book that I wrote called Making It With Music that kind of lays out really the realistic approach to music and what the pros and cons are. I sent this to her, and I think she's finally given up on being a musician once she realized what was involved in it. She thought she was just going to kind of walk out, you know, on the Donahue show or something. It just doesn't work that way.
I think there's a kid scratching a guitar in every other house in America, and I'd hope you sell 100 million books. But help us for those. Give us some of the surprises you've found in your career, and maybe some of the things that the kids don't anticipate.
Well, one of the things that I keep recalling this, the book really is designed, number one, not to make a star out of someone who's not capable, or number two, not interested in being a star. But it's really designed to give a kid with an average amount of musical ability a chance to make a living in a very lucrative business. And you'd think that there would be certain obvious things that a kid would know going out into this. I mean, even though you have to assume we're dealing originally with high school kids, one of the first things the most obvious dumb mistakes that I made, and I lay them all out in the book, you know. But in this particular thing, I remember that the first professional job I went on, I got there and we set up all of the equipment like this, and we're all getting excited. We're supposed to start at 8 o'clock, and about 7:45, I go to the manager and I say, well, when are they going to bring the sound system in? He says, well, I thought you had a sound system. So he didn't have a sound, and neither did we, and consequently, we lost the night's work, we lost the money, we'd driven something like 250 miles to do this job.
Now, and by sound system, you had your black boxes.
No,
right?
All we had were our instruments, because almost, you know, like we came here today, we didn't bring microphones, we didn't bring this, we didn't bring the house
in.
And we could have done our music,
but
no one would have heard us.
In other words, you had no amplification in the room.
Right, no one would have heard what we were doing, which to me strikes me as being terribly dumb on somebody's part. Yeah. Mine for not at least asking if they had it, and his for not.
How do you keep track of the money with so many bodies involved, from the guy who owns the hall, to the guy taking the tickets, to the guy producing the record, to the guy, the publicist, the photographer on the jacket?
It's tough getting started. I mean, there are three or four different categories you're talking about. One is personal appearances. That's easier to control. Record-wise, there are a couple of people in the business who are notorious for being, they track down problems in record companies. So what you do is you contact these people. You have it written into your contract that you have the right to audit every so often, at least once a year or whatever you feel is necessary, whatever your pay schedule is. And the trick is to utilize that audit, because while it costs you a little money, almost every time they go in, they find discrepancies. They're not illegal things. They're not things the record company is intentionally doing to you. It's interpretation of contract, you know, and my interpretation might be a little different from someone else's. So usually, it's very seldom an audit won't pay for itself. And it's amazing how much money can be found in those audits.
Even with country and western coming more and more to the forefront, I think we'd all have to admit that the hottest sound in music today is a disco beat, and I'm curious as to your reaction to the disco sound.
I think it's great. First of all, I am one of those people that I think the more different types of music there are, the longer music itself will survive in a solid form. And I think that disco music is here for a while, because the one problem I see with disco music right now is that the lyrics to disco music, they're not substantive. There's nothing to them.
I think that all sounds alike.
They do, but if you're dancing, who cares? You know, that's the whole thing is, it's really, they're not there to listen to the lyrics. They're there to dance. The problem that I see coming with disco is that if someone before long doesn't come in with lyrics that have some intelligent approach to them, people listening to them on the radio, if you can't dance in your car, you're stuck with listening to the lyrics. So sooner or later, it's going to have some substance, or it will go by the wayside, I think.
Kenny, I love your song, Ruby.
Thank you.
And I wondered if you could give us a little background on that and sing it for me, please.
Sure. Can I ask you to hold up on that? I want to kind of save that, because that really has so much importance. I want to talk about it, and we will do it, I promise you. I wouldn't let him out of here.
I would like to know how many times you've been married.
Welcome to Candor City here.
Right? No, I'm not ashamed of it. 26. Yeah. No, I was just... I've been married 1, 2, 3, 4 times. This is my fourth marriage. But I can promise you this. This is also my last.
Was it tough to make the decision the fourth time? Weren't you scared to death?
It's so funny, because I knew her so well before we got married. And when we got married, we had... all of our friends, and we were married at the house. It was we had John Davidson's father perform the ceremony, and John Denver was there, and Glenn Campbell and some friends of ours were there. And
not a bad house for the... I hope they had front pews.
Well, these were the specific people that I was familiar with. Obviously we had personal friends there, aside from people in the business. But I remember when I was standing there, I was thinking, it seems like I should be nervous. And I finally, I'm one of those people that I don't let random thoughts get by me. I try to analyze it and figure out what really is behind the whole thing. And I finally deduced that if you're sure of what you're doing, there's no need to be nervous about it. And I was so totally sure, there was no doubt in my mind, that I was not, to me it was a formality that I felt like I should do for, her family and my family. But as far as I was concerned, it was another day that was really exciting to me because we were both committing at this point.
You have a son?
Son 14, yes.
What can Daddy say, if anything, to this young, growing man who's soon going to discover that girls are different than boys, or if he already hasn't, about avoiding that kind of,
avoiding the girl-boy relationship?
Avoiding four marriages. Avoiding, doing it right the first time, so to speak.
Yeah, I think, unlike a lot of people who are from my generation, I read a book called Future Shock, which totally changed my life because it made me realize that if you don't readjust your social thinking every 10 years or so, that you really are going to get slapped with this future shock. And that really is what the generation gap is. And I think that a child should really know the person that they're intending to marry.
We all said that. I mean, your father told you that himself. The difference is, how do you make, I guess I'd like to know if you're, do you think you might be a smarter tutor because of your own history of broken relationships? That's the question.
I think my broken relationships stem from the business specifically. So unless he is in this business, I don't know that what I have to tell him would be of any benefit. I think if he were in the music business, yes, I definitely could have some specifics, like take your wife with you as often as possible. Most importantly, the one thing my wife taught me, Marianne taught me, I have to clarify that with four marriages. The one thing Marianne taught me was there's a saying that I love so much, that if no one remembers anything but this when you leave here today, that communication is to love what blood is to the body. Without it dies. And if you can't talk, you're wasting your time. And that's what I learned from her.
But aren't we all jaybirds during the courtship? And then all of a sudden, the guy's behind the newspaper.
I think the trick is to accept the fact that sooner or later, you're really going to know pretty much everything intelligence-wise that your partner is going to know. But you will never know all the emotional things, the scars that came from behind. My wife and I got into a situation at one time, and she said to me exactly what we're talking about. She said, if there were one thing I could change about you, it would be that you wouldn't have had all of this previous marriages and this, that, and the other. And she left, and I wrote her a little poem, and the only part I remember was the last verse to it. But to me, it sums up my total attitude about life. And it said, first is for the ego only. I'd rather be last by far. And so I say thanks to those before me because I love you the way you are. And to me, that's what it's all about. I am what I am today because of what I've been through, the good and the bad. And it's not a question of her having to accept what I've been. She should appreciate what's happened to me, because had she met me 10 years ago, the same two people, our relationship would not be what it is today.
Okay, one more question, we'll get out of here. There are some women that don't want their husbands to go bowling because they're always looking at girls, younger women, other women, should say. Now, here you are, Mr. Big, nice-looking boy, You can draw a crowd, I'm sure. Now, is she okay with that? Is she a secure person?
Totally. And I think the truth is, it's because she tells me, look all you want to, don't dare touch. So I enjoy the looking.
Well, now the disco music is taking the beat. Do you think that's going to bring ballroom dancing back?
Don't you hope?
Yeah. Like the good waltzes,
so
the foxtrots, and things like that. We'll live.
To me, one of the sad things about what's happened to music is that people have grown apart, and they're dancing. You can't tell who's dancing with who on the floor. And I don't know that that's wrong. I just think that there's still a place for the personal touching. You get to know someone so much better. Again, remember, I'm 40 years old, so I came up in an era shortly after Glenn Miller and that era. But at the same time, with jazz, it was a very personal one-to-one kind of type of situation in the era that I was brought up in jazz.
I want to get Ruby in, and we'll do that with Kenny Rogers here in Chicago in just a moment. Kenny's album is titled The Gambler, the title song of which you heard just a moment ago. Also, look for Kenny on CBS and his special, special Kenny Rogers coming up on CBS. Ruby became a part of American folklore. I honestly think that sociologists 150 years from now will look back and examine Ruby as, you know, who said that music had to all be fun and games? And it is an art form, and in this particular song, it very painfully reflected our culture. Mel Tillis wrote the song.
Yes.
And you had the smash with it. You delivered it.
The thing I like.
They played this song on the Huntley Brinkley News.
That's what, that was, to me, was the most exciting part of the whole thing.
Can you imagine?
Which really proved the validity. What he said, something that I think was so indicative of what the song really was intended to do. And he said that above everything else, what the song did was it brought war to a one-to-one level. Because the people who died, obviously, were tragedies. But the people who came home with worse tragedies than death, really, that had to live with these things, it made you really realize there were more than one type of tragedy in war.
Here's Kenny Rogers and Ruby.
You've painted up your lips and rolled and curled your tinted hair. Ruby, are you contemplating going out somewhere? The shadow on the wall tells me the sun is going down. Oh, Ruby, don't take your love to town. It wasn't me that started that old crazy Asian war, but I was proud to go and do my patriotic chore. And yes, it's true that I'm not the man I used to be. Still need some company. It's hard to love a man whose legs are bent and paralyzed. And the wants and the needs of a woman your age, Ruby, I realize. But it won't be long, I've heard them say, until I'm not around. Your love to town. She's leaving now, 'cause I just heard the slamming of the door. The way I know, I've heard it slam 100 times before. And if I could move, I'd get my gun and put her in the ground. Take your love to town. Oh, Ruby. For God's sakes, turn around.
And to the backup, the Bloodline, thanks so much. Thanks for being with us. I hope you all have a nice day. Goodbye, everybody.
And promotional fees paid by the following: the all-new Ford LTD for 1979, a new American road car designed to take you across town or across the country in full-size roominess. Test drive the all-new LTD.
True Value Hardware Stores, where quality, selection, and service are why they're number one. True Value is more than just a name, it's their way of doing business.